Without a doubt, Lynden Oscar Pindling was and will always be the hero of heroes to the Bahamian people. Most believe that no other mortal man before or since has touched the people in such a profound way as their Moses, Lynden Pindling, the first Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. He was a godsend, gifted to the people at a time when the great majority suffered in varying ways through a culture perpetrated by a peculiar system of inequality. The masses needed a leader, one who would take on the seemingly insurmountable task of organizing and instructing blacks, most of whom the cruel system had already written off as incapable of building or leading a nation. Pindling, in his prime, returned from law school as a London-trained lawyer, about the age of 22. This in itself was most significant among the masses, since many of them themselves had very little education, if any at all. Additionally, here was this poor black young man, the grandson of a Bahamian seaman and the son of a retired policeman, coming home as a London-trained lawyer and already rolling up his sleeves to take on the power brokers of the day who controlled the people, owned the economy, and ran the government. This is the 50s. The masses are underprivileged, many of them living in dirt-poor conditions. They are still dreaming of working in the banks and walking comfortably on Bay Street. They are still hoping for better education for their children, and they are upset and mad as hell, but unable to verbalize it, or too scared to even make a move against the powerful Bay Street boys. Make no mistake about it, there were the usual 10 or so brave men who were equally up for the task of improving the lot of the great majority. The signs were there almost a decade before, when the road to majority rule begun, and we're talking the 1942 riot. But this was now the 50s. Pindling is back home from the University of London, where he received his LLB degree in 1952. In January 1953, he is called to the English bar, Middle Temple, as a barrister at law, and in August of 53, to the Bahamas bar. As it turned out, the 50s was the decade that molded and readied Lynden Pindling to take on the persona as the people's hero. For it was in 1953 that this handsome and well-physique young man charmed and wooed the Bahamian masses with personality and charisma like no other. Pindling joined the Progressive Liberal Party, the first organized political party in the Bahamas, in 1953, and quickly became the legal advisor to the party. Later in 56, his debonair style and charming flair landed him one of the most beautiful women of the day, Marguerite McKenzie, the slender brown-skinned girl from Long Bay Keys, Andros. Nearing the end of the decade of the 50s, Pindling had accomplished much. He had his education. He had his degree. He had his law practice. He had his political status. He had his beautiful bride. Now he was ready to lock hands and heads with the people of the Bahamas and take his country.
This land is mine.
January 12, 1958 is penned in the annals of Bahamian history as the day that the nation stood still. It was on this day that the long-standing dispute between taxi drivers and tour car operators hired by the Bay Street Boys erupted into the strike. With taxi union leader Clifford Darling on one end and labor crusader Randall Fox on the other end, there in the middle was this short, cool, well-dressed master strategist, Pindling, right there in the mix, calmly pulling the strings. This brought stronger interaction between Pindling and the masses.
So Lynden and myself and Mr. Hannah, Arthur Hannah, he assisted Sir Lynden in representing the union. Well, the general strike came about in January 1958. This was in 1957 when we closed the airport down. And the general strike started in 1958. And that lasted for 19 days. And Sir Lynden was the legal advisor, as I said. And we met at the new airport for that period of time, 2 months every week, until it was all over. Sir Lynden was very instrumental in helping with our problem in solving the strike.
Indeed, it was Pindling who eroded the black craft fallacies of black Bahamians who believed that persons with African roots were not worthy to lead, and those who inherited European culture were simply born to lead. He became chairman of the PLP in 1963, elected to the House of Assembly for the Southern District of New Providence. However, since the general elections of 1967, Pindling had represented Kemp's Bay, Mangrove Key, Andros, even after his party had lost the elections of 1992. It was Pindling who led his party to landslide victories at the polls in 1968, 1972, 1977, 1982, and 1987. Indeed, he served as Prime Minister of the Bahamas for nearly 26 years, from 1967 to 1997, making him one of the longest serving heads of government in the Commonwealth of Nations.
From 1967, I worked shoulder to shoulder with him in the political activities of this country, and I continued as a member of his cabinet until there were only the two of us, up to the last. We were the two last of the original cabinet members.
All right.
And so I know that he has worked extremely hard. He's a man of some considerable intellect. Matter of fact, I don't know anybody up to now to whom you could give an idea, your idea, and when you hear it again, you hear him put it over. You give him you applaud him. You can't be sure sometimes. You can't be sure that was your idea.
I understand.
But that was it. Mm-hmm. He was a great leader. The best, I would think, in this part of the world, in this region. Mm-hmm. And in the Bahamas, unquestionably, he made more contribution than anybody else as a leader. And he had my support every minute of the day. If I was unhappy about something, I spoke to him, discussed it with him, and he would hear what I have to say. If he felt he should do something about it, he would do. If he didn't feel like it, there was nothing that was so serious that I thought I should take any great objection to during that time. As they say, we worked because we wanted to prove that black men could govern. And that is why I remained with him all those days, regardless of what happened. I was there with him because I thought that that was a laudable thing to be able to prove to all those following us in generations to come that black men are capable of governing and doing so quite well.
Despite a life dedicated to frontline politics and development of a people in a country, Lynden Pindling found time to build a family. His children, Obi, Leslie, Michelle, and Monique, in many ways are considered the extended brothers and sisters, children and grandchildren of all God-loving and God-fearing Bahamians. Lynden Pindling, the people's hero, knighted by Her Majesty the Queen January 1, 1983, was always careful and down to earth with the masses. He maintained empathy with them, which made him the most popular figure in his party. He proved himself to be one of the most capable and charismatic political figures the Bahamas has ever produced.
The father of the nation, a true father of the nation, a man would make it possible for all of us, young and old. When he started out, when I started out in my business, it was the foundation Sir Lynden Pindling made. It was his vision to see the small man to come up. And where I am today, it was through his vision. He didn't keep me down. He opened up my eyes to go for myself, to be independent. He helped us, he brought this country from boxcar to old tray, horse and carriage, rugged road. We had no road when Sir Lynden take over this country. It was only track road. And most of all, what I appreciate and love the Prime Minister, the former Prime Minister, may his soul rest in peace, Sir Lynden Oscar Pindling, for the education he gave to the young people. You see, he taught the young people how to make something of themselves. He taught them how to be doctors, lawyers, prime ministers one day, he said, by giving them the right education. He said to the young people in those days, education is the key. In the time when Sir Lynden take over this country, you have to leave school at the age of 14. If you could spell or you can't spell, you had to go.
It is known in this country that he is called the father of the nation, which he really deserves. A very astute politician and a good person to be around. Very friendly and very humble and everything else. And I don't think that you'll find another person here in the Bahamas would be able to, because there's only one Pindling. Just like there's only one Martin Luther King, there's only one John Kennedy. These men were born to be leaders. And thank God that we did have such leaders among us in this country.
Child, let me tell you. Look at here. Before Sir Lynden came in the being, look at every shop on Bay Street had a white light. And you couldn't wait on Bay Street because you was black. Now, I won't talk for the Royal Bank of Canada at all. When Sir Lynden came, he said, no more yes, sir, boss. No more yes, sir, miss. Because before Sir Lynden came, if the child big so, you had to say miss and mister. Then Sir Lynden came into being. That was finished. He say every man is a man and every woman is a woman. No more yes, sir, more. Hire them or regret it. Hire the blacks or regret it. Sir Lynden Pindling. That was a man of God sent him. God sent him to take the shackles off our neck. Without Sir Lynden, we would have been nothing.
After taking office in 1967, Prime Minister Pindling reached a number of major objectives. The Bahamas became a sovereign nation from Britain on July 10th, 1973. Independence for the Bahamas.
Independent Bahamas, 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 Bahamas. Independent Bahamas, Bahamas,
for independence is glory now.
Independent Bahamas,
hail for independence.
Bahamas, independent Bahamas, Bahamas, Bahamas.
And it happened. Everybody played their role as best they could to bring the whole thing to a success. And we had a good leader who understood and who was prepared not to settle for the scraps, because the time came when there were people in the party who were prepared to say, all right, if they give us something here, that'll be all right. But the party, you know, the party song and the party's everything is based on all the way.
All the way.
Yes. And he was the man who was prepared to go all the way, and he had people behind him, good people from every strata of Bahamian life behind him to go all the way. And that's how we got to the point where we could have majority rule and we could get independence. If he were to settle for scraps, we would still be perhaps in the same fix as Bermuda.
No matter what we may say or do, sing it high, hey, sing it low, sing it wherever you may go. In the train.
With the attainment of independence, Prime Minister Pindling created many national institutions, such as the College of the Bahamas, for he was big on education, the National Insurance Scheme, to provide Social Security benefits and assistance, as well as a vehicle for national savings. National insurance is now considered the greatest piece of social legislation ever made for the Bahamian people. Pindling also created the Bahamas Development Bank and the Bahamas Agricultural and Industrial Corporation, established to promote and facilitate business and entrepreneurial enterprises. Finally, the Royal Bahamas Defense Force, to defend the Bahamas and its marine life, provide search and rescue, and disaster preparedness assistance. The Pindling administration spent millions of dollars to improve social conditions in the first decade of the Bahamas' independence. Construction of new roads, schools, clinics, low-cost housing developments, and great improvements in electricity and water and sewage facilities.
A man who gave so much of his life, so much of his time, so much of his efforts, everything to the Bahamian people. That this morning when I awoke while taking my shower, my mind just went back on him, as it often do, because we still miss him so much. But we remember him dearly. We remember him as the kind of leader that I wish some of these other countries would get to bring about what he did for us.
He meant for the liberation of all men, whether we are black or white, rich or poor. God is for us all, and that's what Sir Lynden meant. You know, I look at him as a spiritual leader and also a great natural leader too. He had been, and God bless his soul. Sir Lynden, he was a great man.
Well, back then as a young man growing up, I learned and discovered that Sir Lynden was more like, to me, like a Martin Luther King figure. He pioneered a country. He helped a lot of people in this country to establish themselves, to believe in themselves, and make them believe that they could achieve whatever they, you know, set their heart out to do. You know, despite the difference in opinion, whether PLP, FNM, the man was a good man. You know, and he pioneered this country from back then to what it is today.
He believed in the second chance for every Bahamian. This country, what Sir Lynden Oscar Pindling bring from nowhere to somewhere. You know what he always say? Put in people first. And that's what Sir Lynden did, and that's what he meant. And when he gone down in his grave, he gone down saying he will This country will never be the same until you wipe every tear out of the people's eyes, putting people first. A God-sent man. You hear the story? The people say many are called, but only few were chosen. Sir Lyndon Oscar Pindling was chosen from the Almighty God to lead this beautiful country. What God gave to us the way it is today.
I have a dream.
Pindling's life and dedication to country was not a bed of roses. He had many challenges and overcame most. Black Tuesday, the day the mace was thrown from the Honorable House of Assembly. The split in his beloved PLP and subsequent walkout of the Dissident 8, headed by Cecil Wallace Whitfield. The Grand Bahama Bend or Break speech that changed the way business was being handled in Freeport, Grand Bahama. And of course, the fiery darts of the international media, which inaccurately accused Sir Lyndon of being affiliated with drug smuggling. It was most absurd, and the Commission of Inquiry and the Smith Inquiry found no evidence connecting Sir Lyndon to drugs or drug running. Shaken and hurt, Sir Lyndon would bounce back and capture the 1987 general elections.
Sir Lyndon Pindling. Now you call a name that every time I hear, I just ready to cry. And I would say that it's sad. And sometimes I think about him, I want to cry when he gave his whole life to this country to make us to be better, to make things better. For 25 plus years, even the unborn babies come after he become prime minister and after he even been gone. It's saddened to see what he had to go through after he have helped so many Bahamians, black and white. He make many poor become rich. Many rich become millionaires. Uneducated become well-educated and professionals. And to the end, oh, they treated him so bad. Every day I think about when he had to sat in the Commission of Inquiry. Sir Lyndon has given us everything we needed. Others are taking it to another level or a higher level. But it all started with and from Sir Lyndon Oscar Pindling.
Sir Lyndon Pindling was everything a poor person wanted of a prime minister.
He's the father of this country. I think he is one of the greatest leaders that we ever had in the Bahamas. Sorry that he is gone. I wish he was here today. Maybe he'll be able to solve some of these problems that we're having here. Magnificent. He was a magnificent man. Magnificent. Great hero in this country. Trust me, and every Bahamian should be very proud of him, although he's gone.
Well, Sir Lyndon was, to me, one of the greatest Bahamians because he was instrumental in bringing about majority rule, even though when he and Mr. Hanna, they came from school, they met me and the taxi fellas fighting for that. But as a young lawyer and an educated young man, he stepped into it and he was instrumental in bringing about majority rule in the country, and he was instrumental in the independence for the Bahamas. And I think those two things will stand out in the history of the Bahamas.
It was on July the 9th, 1997, that Sir Lyndon Pindling entered and exited the doors of Parliament for the final time.
But alas, Madam Speaker, it is time now to close the book and say goodbye. As I look around this chamber for the last time, you will indulge me if I say that I see before me not only the faces of honorable members here assembled, but the faces of all those friends and foes who, at various times over the past 40 years, laid claim to the high honor of representing some section of the Bahamian people in this ancient and honorable assembly.
He had come to the end of his very public life as servant of the people. After 41 consecutive years in the Honorable House of Assembly.
I believe, Madam Speaker, that when the history of the Bahamas is written, I sincerely doubt, whether there will be a more prominent name than Sir Lyndon Oscar Pindling in our history.
3 short years after that fateful day, the nation was in mourning. Sir Lyndon, the people's hero, quietly said his final farewell and left us to be with the Lord. The date was August 26, 2000. Sir Lyndon, the people's hero, took flight at the age of 70 after losing the battle to prostate cancer.
Softly, I will leave you softly, for my heart would break if you should wake and see me go. So I leave you softly, long before you miss me, long before your arms can beg me stay for one more hour or one more day. After all the years, I can't bear the tears to fall. So softly as I leave you there,
all the best things in my life have happened since I met you. All the good things that I felt from you. All the nice things to be learned, you taught me in your special way.